He actually teaches one of my favorite classes, so I'm going to go ahead and pub it, Race, Culture, and the African-American Experience. So please, if you are not graduating, go ahead and register for that. In addition, Dr. Harris is also the former director of the African-American Studies and Research Center here at Purdue. He's also one of the world's premier scholars in Alain Locke. He's a prolific writer, prolific scholar with lots, many books, edited works, chapters. Sorry, I'm going to get this mic thing down so I'm not screaming in your ear. He's also known for insurrection ethics and his philosophy surrounding that. And he's also one of the founding members of the philosophy Born of Struggle. So, Dr. Harris is certainly well-versed in plenty of topics, but he has so kindly agreed to talk to us today about Black spirituality, the importance of that in the Black experience. So truly, without further ado, drum roll please, Dr. Harris.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation of the Black Thought Collective. I do appreciate it. Thank you, Rivers, for encouraging me to do this. It's a part of a larger project in text called Why Am I Not a Christian, Black or Otherwise? But this is a small feature of that project. And so I'm just going to try and introduce some problems as opposed to answer some questions within the context of what is contemporary theology and philosophical. By starting out with some books that I think are very interesting. The first book is William R. Jones' book. It's called White Races, a preamble to a Black theology. That was in 1997. And James Cone's book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree. These books are directed very specifically, in the Black community in some senses. And it's got a white racist. But that's a feature of a larger problem called the problem of evil. The problem of evil raises the question of why is there evil in the world? Now, all kinds of religious traditions have this problem. Written civilization tradition of the Buddha has this problem. The first thing that the Buddha said in the Enlightenment series is that life is suffering. A truth is arising, a truth is cessation, a truth is past. So it answers the question of why there's suffering, because that's what life is. It's not why questions, it's redundant. It's like asking, why is white white? That's what it is. Life is suffering as such. So, but there are other traditions as well. The Abraham tradition. Religion is and our faith, which is Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and the Baha'i faith. So that Abrahamic tradition, which is a doctrinal tradition, has a great text. All of which come out of Abraham, faith of Abraham, has its own kind of answer. The most famous one, biggest one, is the North African scholar, St. Augustine, of Hippo's answer to why is there evil. And he answers it in a strange kind of way, actually, two ways. One, he says, well, look, all things that exist are created by God, and God is all good. So evil is not the function of God. He answers it another way, too. He says, God is a great thing, everything. And God can only create good things, so evil wasn't created by God. So he answers it in kind of two ways. But in both cases, evil is not something which is attached to God. It's separate from it. It's a function of human agency. But you have other answers, too. You have the answers that come out of the sagacious traditions, which are not. Like Yoruba thing. Why is there evil in the world? There's evil in the world on this account, and because you have the energies of the demonic, the energies of God, So all the energies in the universe are a feature of God, in which case evil is also a feature of God. So why is there evil? Well, because that's a feature of God. Okay. And then you have the Baha'i, and the Baha'i faith too, is sort of Abrahamic tradition of why there is evil. Another Baha'i, racism is a sin. It's the last of the last largest of the Abrahamic faiths. So they all have answers to questions, you know, why is there evil in the world? And the question that Jones raises is, you know, is God white racist? Is a feature of that question. God, what Jones wants to know is, you know, if God is all-powerful, omnipotent, omnipresent, omnipotent, then how can he let, why racism exists, and God must be a racist, because there's racism in the world, so it's got to be associated with God in some way. Now, what's Jones' answer to this question? Is God a white racist? Part of his answer is that, you know, we can't answer that question. He favors what he calls a human-centered faith. A human-centered orientation to religion, to black theology. He says we need a liberation theology. And a liberation theology is one which would place the need for human liberation at its center. So he focused on human liberation. And so in some sense, Jones does not answer the question, is God a racist? Because in some sense, he has to accept the way in which he conceived God anyway. That God is not only a racist, but he's a sexist, a homophobic, a pedophile, a murderer, a thief, and everything else. Because everything is God. So in some ways, he doesn't really want to answer that question. They see him in the focusing on the divine benevolence as a kind of a feature of the oppressor's mechanism to disguise of oppression. White Christianity focuses on the benevolence of God, but that just is a disguise, the continuation that allowed them to continue to oppress, at least well off, or oppress slaves. So it says, we should argue for the argument for black liberation theology that adopts a kind of new theism that's informed by humanist principles of functional alternancy and human choice. It's human choice, in a sense, that determines our position for slaves. So in any way, Jones' account is the same account as St. Augustine's. He separates why slavery exists, why racism exists, from its origin. The origin winds up being human agents. And where freedom, the possibility of freedom, is also a function of human agents. So Jones gives us something of a St. Augustinian account of why there are people in the world, and is whether or not God. Whether or not God is a racist. So it separates the two. But there's another text also that I find, a friend of mine, by the James Cone. Now James Cone has this book, The Cross and the Lynching. What's Cone's approach to the cross and the lynching? Cone says, well, look, the cross has a very special function, and suffering has a very special function in the history of black religion. We use suffering, we've seen suffering in the context of black music, hymns, blues. We find comfort in faith. And black suffering is described in these terms, described in these texts, music or cultural formations. He criticizes a white philosopher named Reinhold Niebuhr for not seeing how important the cross is within the conflict of black religion. And he says, to quote Cone, faith and doubt were bound together, thinking about what faith was among slaves, with each a check against the other, doubt preventing faith from being too sure of itself, and faith keeping doubt from going down into the pit of despair. A symbol of death and defeat, God turned the cross, says Colin, into a sign of liberation and new life. The cross is the most empowering symbol of God's loving solidarity with the least of these, the unwanted in society who suffer daily from great injustices. So for Colin, the cross is a symbol of relief, the cross is a symbol of liberation, the cross is a symbol of new life for the least of these, and the least well-off. So he doesn't answer the question why there is suffering. What's the cause of suffering? He takes again the sort of St. Augustine approach and doesn't contribute God as being the cause of suffering. But he says what happens is that the cross represents a symbol of relief and redemption. And so he criticized Niebuhr for not seeing that the cross is the symbol within the context of Black religion of suffering, but a kind of suffering which is being relieved, is redemptive. So they both, in some sense, take a St. Augustine approach to the answer of why there is suffering and why there is evil in the world, why there is evil in the world, and how should you approach it. They both also rely deeply upon Black religion. Arthur Foster's Black God of the Metropolis, for example, or Campbell's Songs of Zion, or Albert Robertson's African American Religion, all tell us that one of the characteristic features of Black religious heritage and spirituality is this question of suffering and the problem of evil. And how do you address it? How do you answer that question? And Black intellectuals and theologians have to sort of answer that question in a way which white authors and theologians don't. Because they have to answer that question because they see religion as a kind of source of not only truth, but of social redemption. And that's kind of served this dual function, not just one function. And so the source of is this meaning of the meaning of Black slavery is unique to this tradition, the meaning of suffering is unique to this tradition, and the importance of redemption, the importance of a better future world, and the institution as a bulwark against prejudice, humiliation. It provides a social network, it provides financial resources. So their theology is not just concerned with the pragmatics of whether or not the text is true, but also how this text works within the context of a social condition of suffering, the social condition of humiliation, the social condition of prejudice. It's within, they're operating within, of course, the Abrahamic tradition to answer these questions. Those are some of the unique features that I find in Black theological works that are what's called philosophical theology. They're not the only features, there are a whole lot more after certain. But let me go back to Jones's question. Is God a white racist? It seems to me that that question can be unpacked in a lot of ways. I'm going to try to unpack some features of the question that Jones raised. Is God a white racist? One of the problems is that is a problem beyond philosophy teleology. The cross, for example, for Colin is an example of redemption. Liberation is a symbol of liberation, it's an image of liberation, and future redemption. But teleology is about an end state. What's the goal? And he assumes as an endpoint that there is a goal that is inclined towards something. The suffering has a meaning towards some kind of some event in the future. He assumes that there's going to be a contiguous agent. The person who is suffering now will be the person in the future who gets redeemed. And that future redemption is somehow supposed to take care of their current misery. It's recursive. There's a problem of utility. One of the features that Ravenel talks about is how blacks see religion, at least some blacks, particularly in the evangelical tradition. He says, Ravenel says, in a fascinating book and piece called The Meaning of Slavery, he says, blacks could accept Christianity because they rejected the white version, which is trapping of slavery and caste for upper and more authentic gospel. They were certain that God did not condone slavery and that he would end it. The problem was how and when. While black evangelicals believed that the issue was ultimately in God's hand, they also believed that God used instruments, that is, that they were a tool in this process for a larger purpose. One of the purposes, he said, for example, is to improve white Christianity. Another purpose would be to the aims of a future liberation of all humanity, a future improved world. Another role that they're playing will be models of virtue. Okay, well, this is the problem of instrumentality. What role do you have in this cosmic narrative? What role are you to play? What role is this group, or role are these individuals to play? In this cosmic narrative. There's another problem associated with Jones's question, and that's the problem of existential meaning. The existential meaning problem is this. He's assuming a moral universe. But as Jones and Cohen both assume that the universe is a place in which human agency has meaning beyond itself. Good acts are somewhere recorded as good acts. And bad acts are somewhere recorded as bad acts. And bad acts get punished and good acts get rewarded. Or the universe is somehow inclined, like Martin Luther King Jr. said, the arc of justice is long. But he thinks that just that history is inclined to produce justice in the future. So he thinks in terms of a moral universe, one of which human agency has existential meaning beyond itself. And he also thinks in terms of purpose. They both think that the universe has a purpose. Our individual lives are in some way self-summative within that larger purpose. So they think that this existential question is our existence is not just the existence as an individual such that I exist as a consciousness, and what happens to me or what I do matters only to me, but rather my existence is a function of something such that there's a moral content to it that has a meaning independent of me as an individual. And it has that moral content is in some way recorded somewhere in the universe so that we can talk about human existence as a kind of existence which is inclined to do something good or bad. That's a moral universe, which Jones and Cohen are presuming that we are in. There's another problem, the problem of creation. From causation. The question, is God a white racist? It's presaged on the background of causation. It's assumed that there's an agent here. We want to know the source. That is, Jones is saying, is God the cause of? Or is God a part of? Is God a creator of? Is God not just this thing that's a racist that just happens when we have a belief, but is God a gentle agent in the world who's a racist? So his background on an assumption of causation here, operative assumption of causation, but he's not telling us the details of that. He's not simply saying that racism is an accident, happenstance, a mistake. So but it's out here. And he wants to know the linkages between it. Is God causing my misery? So there's another problem here. There's a problem of ontology. Jones and Cone says, you know, this is the life of black people. He uses an example of black people in the South. And he has personal experiences with people being lynched and how the horrible effect that has on himself and others, constantly being afraid and constantly in terror, the hurt for which it produces. And so the cross becomes very redemptive in that context once you're faced in that context of that community. Then you also talk about, you know, black people as people, or slaves as a community, as if they were an ontological entity, as if they were a collective body. Some slaves are better off than others. One or two black people on occasion own slaves. So if slavery is to be treated as kind of a coherent body with just only suffering, then it doesn't really match reality. It's much more variegated than that. Are we talking about the slaves in Mississippi who are constantly beaten, terrorized? Are we talking about the slaves in New York? Or the slaves in Cincinnati? Or those who live in upstate New York? Or are we talking about those in Louisiana? So we're treating slavery as if it was a ubiquitous phenomenon with an ontological character with bounded features, which are nice and neat, and we can talk about it as a collective body that's undifferentiated. The same with black people. You can talk about the misery of black people, but then you have to engage in a certain kind of recognition that you know full well that your class divided. You know they're divided by geography. You know they're divided by age. You know they're divided by experience. You know they're divided by religion. But yet you can talk about black people as a collective body and their common experiences, but you also have to constantly evaluate and reevaluate what you mean by it. So Cone is and Jones are presaging a sort of ontological agency here that they don't fully discuss yet. So those are some of the kind of philosophical issues that we raise when we ask this one question: is God a white racist? That one question, what we do then is that this question is a part of a larger question, the problem of evil. The problem of evil has been addressed by humanity for generations, you know, for a very long time. We can find it in all sorts of religious traditions. We can find it even among King Izana, the first Christian in Ethiopia, in 341 A.D., who joins the faith and decides that what we now call Ethiopia, used to be called Abyssinia, before that was Thomas Oxen, to join that faith. He has to address the problem of evil properly. It says that the form of religion is already demonic. So no matter which orientation you go, the question is, it has a larger dynamic. My point is that Jones' question is, it fits within a much larger feature, and the problems that I've raised so far are ways to look at how it is, they are avoiding features of the answer. But the answers that they give entail other kinds of questions. I'm not trying to answer all those questions, right? I'm not trying to answer the question of the existential question of meaning. You know, what is the meaning of suffering? What is the meaning of slavery? Why do you think it has a meaning? Because are you presupposing the moral universe where things have a purpose? Okay, so those are some of the kinds of ways to talk about this problem that is so central to black spirituality. It's so important to that history of religion, no matter which version of that religion you're talking about. evangelical version, the Baptist version, the Episcopalian, Catholic. Those questions are constantly a part of that tradition, which has, as a part of its history, a tremendous impact, has created a community where people have been able to have a life as opposed to being constantly faced with prejudice, constantly excluded. It provides a resource. And so each one of those books that I mentioned begin to discuss those resources, resources which very often are ignored among white Christians. Now, let me ask some other questions out of the box. Because this lecture was supposed to be titled, Out of the Box. But the first part of it was that it's really important to respect and appreciate this history of philosophical theology among black people. Because very often you won't get it in traditional philosophy classes. Because the problem of evil is not central. It's secondary. Whereas for here, and the problem of evil is thought of very often in strictly philosophical terms, what kinds of metaphysical essence do you want to have? But the problem of evil, for a good deal of black philosophical theology, has to do with how does that relate to the misery that I'm suffering now. How does that particularly relate to racism? Especially because the people who are talking about it are themselves racist. They're coming out of a Christian tradition, and they are themselves racist. Cone is talking to a community that is dementia. And he's got to figure out a way of accounting for this symbol that they both use. Niebuhr uses the same symbol as redemptive, but he doesn't see it as, according to Cone, as redemptive within the context of lynching, where the lynching is not just about the individual, but about terrorizing the community. So Cone wants to say, look, the cross is not just a symbol of Jesus dying and being redeemed and saving our souls, but it's also a sample of the misery of the present. And here we can see individuals, and he has some examples of his own family and folks associated with him, where they needed to see that symbol as a redemptive. Those philosophical questions are much more enriched when you look at this tradition. So those other questions that I raised, the problem of ontology, causation, the problem of existence, they are complicated when you introduce the phenomenon of racism and exploitation. You have to ask a different kind of question. You have a different sensibility when you ask these questions. In those great books that I mentioned, there are only a few of them. Arthur Fawcett's Black God for the Metropolis raises. So look, the practice of the faith in the black community is very different from the practice of the faith in the white community. You see these people of expression and emotion. That's not just some sort of cultural dance project. That's an expression of faith and a way in which that faith is supposed to be answering the question of suffering. So it's not just saying they're just happy or something. They're saying, look, I've gotten saved or something, not just saying, golly gee. And whereas white people sitting there saying, oh, that's nice. Thank you very much. But this is a matter of a release within the context of a faith. So that's what I think this is, if you put how the philosophical theology of this heritage reshaped the philosophical questions and how you understand. But there's a second point to my lecture about this out of the box. Jones's question, is God white racist? Let me ask a slightly different one. What questions does a conceivable answer to which would be consonant with nurturing conviviality? Why don't we ask a different set of questions? Because the very question sets up the possibility of the answers. Is the nature of the question in part dictates what you can conceive of as a right answer. For example, the place in Socrates' Euthyphro, which is written by Plato, not Socrates, Socrates' Euthyphro. Socrates asks Euthyphro, what is the nature of holy? Or sometimes it's translated from the as piety. So Euthyphro says, well, you know, I'm suing my father for murder. So that's what it is to be pious or holy. And Socrates says, well, that's not an adequate answer to the question. Well, what's Socrates' real question? His real question is, what is the nature, what is the form of piety? Or what is the form, what it is to be holy? And Euthyphro answers with these particular events, you know, what I'm suing, or what the gods believe. So I said, well, that's inadequate. Or what all the gods believe, that's inadequate. Why is it inadequate? Because Euthyphro is not telling him the nature of the form. He's telling him particular events associated with what it is to be pious. So I said, well, look, you know, I don't want to know what I want to know what the nature of the form is, independent of whether the gods think that it's true or not. Is it true because the God says it is, or is it true independent of what the God says? It's got to turn out to be true independent of what the God says, because that determines the nature of the thing itself. This man has no answer. He doesn't really have an answer. Blah, blah, blah. Yeah. Neither is Socrates. Socrates didn't tell you what the nature of the form is either. He read his question. But my point is that he sets up Euthyphro with the question. So the possible answer that he could give has to be in a certain kind of certain form. The criteria for the answer is encoded in the nature of the question. What is the nature of piety? It presupposes that there is a nature, and that nature is defined by a form, but he's never answered that. He's never told you why he thought there was a form in the first place. Such that particular things are feature. Why use that conception of things at all? Why not do it the other way around? Everything's a particular, nothing that's a form. Why not do it in Buddhist fashion? You can't answer the question anyway because you're using language. Language always entraps you. Present tense, past tense, future tense, generalizations. Can't answer the question using language. See, you're using the wrong tools. Sorry, that never happens. So my suggestion is maybe this question is, let me interrogate this question. Is God a white race presupposing God? People already know what racism means. And in background is, I'm assuming a moral universe. Now they have an Aristotelian answer to this question. But let me proceed and just say, raise some other some kind of interesting issues. Or at least what I take to be interesting issues. And then I'll terminate this brief, an all too brief introduction to black religion, because it's a fascinating subject, which I'm not an expert. I'm only a student, and I hope to remain a student. When I think about Jones's answer to the question, is God a white racist? Not only brilliant, you know, just fascinating. But maybe Jones fails to answer the question properly. Because, in the following way, let's suppose that Jones is right, that what we need is a black liberation theology, and not relying upon the whole theology trying to answer the question, is God a white racist, i.e. answer the question of the problem of evil. But if that's the case, and if Jones is emphasizing human agency, the way in which St. Augustine emphasized human agency, why do I need a theology anyway? What's the point? I mean, I should focus on human agency. If humanity is created of evil, then naturally I should focus on it. I should think about how to change that situation, how to change their selections and choices and preferences. Because clearly God is not operating in this context. If I'm going to treat it in that fashion, if I'm going to demink it in that way, it's not God that I have to rely upon to change this. I have to rely upon human agency. If Jones is right, that freedom and slavery are a function of human agency, then the death of them, the death of slavery and racism, is also a function of human agency. And I don't need a theology. What I need a theology for. I mean, it's nice, pays the bills, I'm not complaining, I like my job, don't get me wrong, really like the job. You're a good guy. I like everybody. Yep. Well, I can't. I'm showing up every day. Why does John need a theology? Naturally, he needs one. Why does he need a theism? He says we have to have a baptism. Why does he need a theism? Why does he need a perception of God at all? Let alone this one, let alone a Christian one. Why should I have that? What's the point of that? You know, there's no cosmic story that I have to have. And there's no role that this suffering is playing. Slaves were beaten in a slave ship of Jesus Maria. You know, the crew raped over they raped all the women on board, all those except who partially speak Spanish or Portuguese. They killed the cabin boy and threw him overboard. The captain killed the cabin boy and threw him overboard. There are about hundreds of slaves on that ship that were brutalized. Their names are not known. They're dead. What role do they play in what cosmic story? And whatever role they played, their pain happened. So, why do I need theism? I don't see if the answer is right there, what's the point of this? The other is that it's not clear that's helpful. I'm going to return to Jones in a minute, but let me ask a slightly different question about Cone. Cone is, I asked James Cone 2 years ago at the Philosophy for a Struggle conference where he gave his discussion of this wonderful book that he had. I asked him, Cone, I know him. James, I'm working on this book called Why I'm Not a Christian Black Otherwise. I don't know if I could do this, man. What you think?
He said, well, Harris, I think it's a good idea.
Anytime you talk about faith, that's a positive thing. So, you know, I'm coming from a different angle there. I don't want to be, talking to just my friends. It's okay. But anytime people talk about faith, That's a good thing. I mean, arguing at Philosophy for a Struggle, white people hear for the most difference. And we recorded it. So you can get it at our library, at Philosophy for a Struggle, our website. This wonderful defense of this text of the cross and lynching. He defended that view because it's an image of faith. It's an image that promotes faith. There's two features of this, my concern. The one is, that image didn't prevent lynching. Didn't happen. The people that he knew were still lynched. Whatever that image is good for, is not good for stopping terror. It might be good for feelings of redemption and solace, but it won't help you prevent lynching from happening. It didn't. The other is faith. And that's what's crucial to me, I think. The more important thing in this is, Cone promotes the importance of faith. As he pointed out earlier, without faith, he seems to move into despair. This is crucial, because in some sense, he's right. I don't see how you're going to argue against that sometimes. In your darkest hours, you need something to hold on to. You've been arrested for no good reason at all. You forgot your driver's license at home. You're a woman. They're taking you to the city county jail. 7% of all women in county jail, according to Angela Davis, are raped. The people that arrested you were Christian. The people that judged you were Christian. The people that put you in jail were Christian. The people that's going to rape you are Christian. Sometimes you need something to help you get along. What do you have but faith in something? Hope. So in some sense, you know, he sets up this dichotomy. He's right sometimes. I wouldn't deny that. That's the case. But faith's got a problem. Faith is a weapon of the weak. Sometimes protest is a weapon of the weak. Not working hard is a weapon of the weak. Stealing from your employer is a weapon of the weak. Writing letters in protest, I've been writing letters all my life, weapon of the weak. Weapons of the weak do not defeat the strong. Faith is great and comes as you, but it doesn't do you any good as a weapon of the strong. It's a wonderful thing, that way he describes it. And you need it. But at the same time, he vests in a great deal in its agency. It has no agency like that. It can't do that work. I don't see how it can do this work anyway. I don't see how it can do the work with the kind of agency that he wants. Because he doesn't just want redemption. He also wants freedom. So if that's the case, then maybe Cone and Jones have a similar difficulty here, in one way at least. A similar difficulty associated with agency and faith. What they both need is power. Who owns the bank? Who owns the mortgage of the church? All the people sitting in church got a car loan. Who owns that loan? Who owns a construction company? What's the name of the banker of Faith Baptist Church around the corner? Is he black? Who owns a gas station there? Family Dollar. What construction company did they use to build it? What's the name of their accountant in charge of the finances? Who's their lawyer? Maybe he's not asking the right questions about his faith, about his comrades or himself. Who owns that? Does he really think that the ministers there don't know who the races are? They hear their confessions all the time. They sit by their deathbed all the time. Does he really think that they don't know? Does he really think that the ministers of the black church don't know who the drug dealers are? Does he really think that? I mean, does he really think that it's just a matter of faith? Maybe it's also a matter of a different kind of conception of agency. Because the image can't end social misery. That can't happen. Another way to think about this is this wonderful book called The Songs of Zion. I mean, James Campbell's Songs of Zion, African Methodist Episcopal Church. How is it deeply dedicated and faithful individuals of the African Methodist Episcopal Church raise this very same question. Is God a white racist? And the answer is definitely not. Not only is not God a white racist, but God is a God of redemption and saving. So one of the things that was famous about the African Methodist Episcopal Church is that they had missionaries. And so this particular book is about that missionary, about that conjunction between Africans, African Americans, and Africans. Because the African Methodist Episcopal Church sent missionaries to South Africa. In the midst of apartheid, they stepped into the water, so to speak, the worst foreigners on the planet, to promote their faith. But there were two orientations in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. One was deeply committed to fighting prejudice. And they both could not abide by the races in South Africa or the races here in America. But one was a bit more reticent about fighting apartheid than the other. But they both had to acquiesce to some degree to apartheid in order to promote the faith. So what it's about, in some sense, is the faith. The social mission is secondary, not primary. Those who were not as aggressive as the others about the faith participated in missionary work. But what's the purpose of the missionary work? Not only to promote economic development and social improvement among Africans, but also to destroy the traditional African religions. That's what missionaries do. They destroy other people's religions and promote their own. So here African Americans are members of the world of high technology. You've got wool shirts and wool coats, cotton cloth, leather shoes, white shirts. Women have hairdressers, skirts. That's all high technology. There are no woolen clothes. There are no factories producing those in South Africa among black people. So they do the same thing as the white Christians do. They take the children and raise them. They're good Christians. They need to promote their faith. They see themselves as redeeming those who are lost. It's the faith that matters. The social mission is a part of it. But there is no social mission without the faith. So they are part of modern technology, a part of the modern society that helps bring modernity to South Africa and simultaneously help destroy the Joker religion and replace it with a new creative religion. And they were successful in many regards in promoting and encouraging the ending of apartheid while at the same time living with apartheid. The same as most religions. Almost all religions found a way to live with misery. Whether it's feudalism, slavery, aristocracy, capitalism, communism, socialism, find a way. Whether it's Nazism, find a way to live with and promote the faith. That's the subtext that's in conflict with what Jones wants. That's why the St. Augustinian answer, I think. Those are some of the internal conflicts, I think, are there. Which may be why, when we think about this question of is God white racist, what we are actually asking of that question. We're not just asking, is God a white racist? We're also asking about an existential question about the meaning of life. We're also asking, what's the utility? We're also asking, is there a moral universe? We're also asking about causation. We're asking, Jones is asking a lot of questions, so to speak, that are background of this most difficult and terrible issue that he's raising. So, that's sort of thinking out of the box, and I'm the kind of folks that sometimes think out of the box in this way. People like Herbert Harrison, James Baldwin has thought out of the box this way. Alice Walker has thought out of the box in this way. Norman Allen, Octavia Butler, the wonderful book on Dalton Wright. Neil deGrasse Tyson, the physicist, thinking out of the box in this way. Shreema Hutchinson has a wonderful book called Moral Conduct. Amadisa Thomas, she has a book called Contradictions. a question of faith. How do you have faith in the context of the Black community? And also have a lot of churches, and it's a poor community. And these questions of whether or not God exists and is God a racist were not just asked by intellectuals. They were also asked by slaves. Peter Randolph's sketches of slave life gives you, you know, examples of slaves that are asking these questions. How is it that I can have this kind of misery? And you tell me that there's a deity. How does that work? Slaves, this is also the 22 years of slave, does the same thing, ask these kinds of questions. You don't have to be, you know, a philosopher, intellectual, or a theologian to ask these questions. They come out of this condition of servitude. So let me end with a quote from Elaine Reel, and that's, those are the kind of traditions that I find fairly interesting. Locke says, by the imperative philosopher by the name of Blaine Locke, who's associated with the Baha'i faith in regards. He says, you know, all philosophies are the ultimate derivations, philosophies of life. Out of the box. I'm done. I think it was a great thing.
So everyone, thank you for coming to this. I'm gonna open it up for questions. Dr. Harris is a busy man with lots of questions, working on answers, so we won't take up too much of his time.
I'm getting too many problems at once. I thought I'd leave the problems out.
I just wanted
to get some sense of what philosophers ask sometimes. Yeah.
I have a question. You said about the crosses and how it relates to Black culture.
Mm-hmm.
What about the unk? Like, does the unk?
The unk? I don't know what the unk is.
You don't know what the unk is?
No, I don't know what the unk is. Oh, okay. There are lots of different versions of the cross.
Right.
And the cross that you use is a very modern picture of a cross. That's a very modern cross. There's a straight line, I think, and then you have the oval on top. Your cross, even your churches are very modern structures. The older church, for example, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, I had the honor of meeting the Holy Father, but I've been appalled here in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. Those churches were around. And you go to a church where it's not around, and you have a podium up front, ministers in front of you. That's kind of new. And the holies of the holies are sitting in the center, and people worship them around. The symbol of the cross that you use, Cone doesn't use that symbol. So I didn't talk about it. So I don't have much to say about it at all. Because Cone doesn't use the traditional, the contemporary symbol of the Christian cross, not the older version.
I kind of wanted to ask about this idea of when suffering kind of comes along with Christian faith and martyrdom.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you're very well traveled. And so one thing I've always noticed, or that maybe more recently has been like, actually thinking about, is this kind of how we put martyrdom as a huge virtue, I guess.
There's a problem here with seeing the cross as redemptive. It's not so much a question of honor, it's a question of sacrifice and expecting to be redeemed by virtue of that sacrifice. the suffering and then the redemptive moment. The point is that the suffering doesn't, you have in fact suffered. Nobody stopped it. But that's a feature of that particular faith. They think that's a positive good because it's an example. It gives you an out, it gives you an exit to the hope for the possible future. And that's a feature of their faith. It doesn't mean that they're completely subordinate or something, but of course, when a person perpetuates the slave religion, they try to make people subordinate, although those people practice just otherwise weren't. So it's not a necessary feature of subordination. It depends upon the context of what she is. And that's not martyrdom. That's an example of a model of sacrifice. So here's a model that you can live by, so to speak. But that's not martyrdom. Martyrdom is something slightly different than that. So I don't think Conor Jones, I think that the cross represents martyrdom. I think it represents a symbol of salvation in this context. So I critique that. I suggested a possible line of critique, namely that that's a sad symbol. Because you don't get the only control of nothing. You step on that symbol. Step on that image. It's an image of perpetual suffering. How is that image good for me? I'm trying to raise this question. The significance of calling the other's place in the symbol as a positive good, especially when he's well off. That's why I raise a whole different set of questions and counter-distinctives. But it's not hard. That's what I think anyway.
Do you think without Christianity that there would be an institutional slavery in North America?
I don't know if that's an answer to that question. Because there's no history otherwise. There is. But I'd say, Orlando Patterson has a very good book on slavery. And this is slavery around the world and throughout human history. American slavery is not, on his account, not all that unique. And certainly not very old. You think about the slavery that the Dalits suffered in India, you're talking about a couple thousand years here. Or you think about slavery within China, go back 10,000 years. You've been enslaved for 200. Not very long. And kind of torture and misery that Americans practice. They learn. They've been brought over from other places. Slavery in Europe. Gloucester County in England was 90% slaves, 16th century. Rome, 30% of the households in Rome were considered slaves. Roman soldiers who included persons of African descent enslaved persons in Cardiff, Wales. So you see, pictures of Africans who were Romans enslaving people in Cardiff, Wales. The British were considered to be unfit to be slaves because they're too inferior to be household slaves in some parts of the empire. Too ignorant to even have those houses. The Zulu were really, they strong in power, slave. The Asante were also slavers. They're other populations. They're old slave society. Slavery doesn't come to an end in Mauritius. Slavery becomes a crime in Mauritius. In 2007. So in some sense, American slavery has its unique features, but it's not its cruelty. It's a part of a world system, world history of cruelty, where people practice various forms of slavery. Your shadow is infected. You don't have to be a Christian to be a slave owner. That's not unique to Christianity. You could be Jewish, you could be Muslim, you could be anything, depending upon the culture and system. The vice president of the Confederacy was Jewish. Slavery in the Atlantic Mediterranean, slaves. People who were in positions sometimes, creating eunuchs. Of all kinds of things, Jewish, Muslim, and Muslim. So, if you think about slavery in the rural context as a kind of suffering, then this question has a big question here. It's not, Jones's question is about white slavery in America, or, white racism, which besides the point slavery, but the very idea of something being, people being white in the first place is a fairly modern project. We're not only divided and just being black and white people. I don't think it's just peculiar to Christianity. It's not at all peculiar to Christianity. That too is a problem for this theology that he wants to create. Can't just reduce it to Christianity, I don't think. The white people are definitely one of them, too. I think about slavery in Europe. Say, well, I'm British, well, they always been nice people. Anybody didn't come, anybody slaves. society for slaves, Gauls, slaves, Visigoths, they didn't come up, anybody slaves. I'm familiar. Well, you're a slave.
Do you think that the ability to separate faith from social practices is an aspect of strength?
Yeah, I think it's a problem. I think it's a problem for black theology. I think it's a problem for any black theology, but in particular black theology. Because very often you need the people who have been suffering from oppression and humiliation. You want your faith to do something more than just be a faith. Needed to be something more than just faith. So the secularist or the atheist and the agnostic say, well, it's just a faith. And it's just an institution that, if you think Marx is right, it's the opium of the masses. Or if you think Friedrich Nietzsche is right, God is dead. In the sense that people don't really believe God anymore. So it's really hard to make that separation neatly. And you can, and people do, certainly, but what's the point of that separation? Sometimes the point is to promote the importance of the faith as faith itself. That's one reason the liberation theologists in Latin America have such difficulty. Because they wanted the faith to also be a function of politics. Sometimes that doesn't work. Especially when it comes to conflict, we have to ask the question, what's more important? Building this institution as a religious institution or terminating Israel? Sometimes you don't get to show us. Sometimes you choose, some people choose graduation of the institution, religious institution, plus practice. And that was moral combat for argument, part. Talk faith, but really this is a business. That's why you have so many black churches in poor neighborhoods. The community was still poor. So that's her concern, that's her approach. So I don't know if you can do it that way. I don't know if you want to. Some people do that. So that's a good question. Yes, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm.
This is kind of a unique question, but I've had conversations with friends, and I've tried to convince them that institutional racism exists, and they don't believe that it does. When you talked about who owns the gas station, who's the accountant, who is sort of at the top It made me think of this question because my friends will say, well, there's no law that, that black people can't be accountants, so where is the racism? And so I've had a difficult time explaining it to them. So is there some sort of term or place that I could look to give them concrete evidence and statistics?
Well, yeah, a lot of my books on racism help you do that. I can give you something off the top on the typical work stuff. Just reading from a lot of material on law and the mentalities of the law, how people see colorblind actually functions. And it's color conscious all the time. One of the characters, an example, is if you have a contest for people who have had architectural experience, and you're going to give an award, say you're going to have an internship at your architectural firm, and all you need is a year of architectural experience to apply. It just turns out that no women can apply. It's gender blind, right? The rules don't specify no women, but the structure systemically excludes. Or she has traditionally applies for a loan, and she has all of appropriate qualifications, but the loan officer thinks she's black, so he uses another criteria. Well, the houses in his neighborhood are not increasing in value, and so you don't have enough income to justify buying a house in this neighborhood because it's decreasing in value. Well, he doesn't use race to do it. He selects a different criteria to apply. That's institutional racism. That's a feature of institutional racism. But it operates only within the context of the people's behavior. The rules don't do that. In terms of the problem of religiosity, you can talk about the existence of the faith, but you know there are large black congregations, mega churches. White and black mega churches, they are just white and black. They both practice the same faith. They probably buy the Bibles from the same company. So, but institutionally, they're very different. I can understand how that can be difficult thing. Because you don't see it, it's hidden, it's blind.
We don't live in a colorblind society, that's what's said. Ethnic blind society, or religious blind society, Islamophobia, and all sorts of things. But yeah, I see the problem, I don't have an answer for it.
All right, I encourage you to look at some of the books that I've suggested by these hands that are about humanism. Black humanist, Anthony Penn, Our Lord by Anthony Penn, another good book. There's a very interesting text that raises interesting philosophical issues. And I hope I'm giving you some food for thought. I try desperately not to answer any questions, but to promote a certain sense of humanist tradition. And that tradition raises questions. Like these. That tradition is much a part of the black community. So I'm right. Thank you.